So I would like to request Prof. Sinha to start the panel discussion, and as he would be chairing the session, and he has kindly agreed in a very short notice to chair the session. So thank you, sir.
Friends, let me take this opportunity to invite myself to be the first panelist. Well, this is the assignment given to me, and let us begin. I have been deliberately asked to talk about the book and the person, the author and, all right, the author and the work. These two things I start with. You see, the book, many persons have asked, what is this innovative departure? All of us, we intended to ask the author, and the question remains. I have no answer, but I start with Professor R.K. Jain, the anthropologist. Many of you may not be knowing, he was born at a place, Dalmia Nagar, which is hardly 50 kilometers away from Bhojpur. From Bhojpur, Bhojpuri dialect is known as one of the dialects which is spoken all over the world, wherever the Indian indentured people.
Professor Sinha, he was born in Delhi, but he...
That's what I've learned from him.
Yeah. there's something which we don't know.
No, so please, let me go. Okay. Let me continue. I've learned from him.
That's right.
So, he's one person, Professor Jain. Shibitri Patil Sahib is here. He's senior from Lucknow University. He was trained by D.N. Majumdar, very famous anthropologist at Lucknow. He goes to Oxford, and their famous teacher, Evans Pritchard, he's one of the teachers. He comes back and goes to ANU, Australian National University, and Galaxy, of internationally reputed anthropologist. He did work. He's among very few anthropologists of this country who had chance to work almost all the continents as a student, as a scholar, as a researcher, and even after as a visitor. For example, South Africa. He has been going and working of late. So he is a very rare person who has a very wide, complex. Friends, I'll be repeating a few words. The book I found very intense. Dense book written by an intense personality. Professor Jain is known as a man of very few words. If you ask him something, he starts with humming. And his humming voice has many meanings. And this becomes clear. As an anthropologist, the amount of ethnography he has. And one example I'll give you, this thin book, which we have just released, is hardly 150 pages, the text. But it contains 23 thinly printed pages of bibliography. Just imagine how much work he has digested to produce this book. He's a very well-read person. The amount of ethnography he has got, he digests it, makes general statements, and makes relevant statements. The example, what Sirish Jain has just read, the last paragraph of the book, how much meaning it has, how much text it has, how many messages it has, and how dense it is. I repeat, I give the illustration, the conclusion of the book. You have to take time to read and understand it. I read again and again. I didn't follow many things. Not because of the language, because of the intensity of the debate it contains, the ideas it has, and observe trends, debates, and general statement he has made. If you put all together, you have to scratch your head many times. So you take it as, I take it as a compliment, because ethnologists are known to describe things. They give information. They rarely make statements. Here is one of the anthropologists who has produced a number of works which are very significant. With this, I come to the book part. I repeat, the book is a dense book written by an intense scholar. I see the book in two parts. Number one, a work of anthropology. Those of you who are aware of what anthropology, how the anthropology classical started. Classical evolutionary anthropologists were more concerned with origin of family, origin of marriage, origin of property and state. Today the anthropologists are looking for the roots. In diaspora, people of the diaspora, they look to the roots. Again, our origin in a different way. So origin is not lost. This concern of looking for roots are a living reality of the people, and at the same time it is a concern of the scholars to understand the phenomena, how it got originated. So here is a meeting point of ethnography and the scholarship. Concern of ethnography, I'll give you illustration, two illustrations. In ethnic politics of Mauritius, even among the Indian diaspora, there is a conflict going on between Bhojpuriyas and TMT. Now you may not understand what is TMT. It is Tamil, Marathi and Telugu. Vis-a-vis, Bhojpuri is speaking North Indians. This is the Indian diaspora itself within the conflict. The TMT charges Bhojpuriyas, North Indians, that you are casteists. As if there is no caste among the Tamils and Marathis and Telugus. So what I'm trying to say, from the roots it has gone there. Another example, my son is a British citizen and he lives in Netherlands. He had to visit hospital and he learned, you will be surprised to know, that Dalpuris are the ethnic Indian Sikh diet in Netherlands. Can you understand this? From people from West Indies will understand what is Dalpuri. It is the paratha stuffed with lentils. And this is the Sikh diet for the Surinamese who are settled down in a big number in Netherlands. Because when Suriname became independent, people of Indian origin, they were given a choice. If you want to come to Netherlands, then you are welcome. And many of them, they settled down in Netherlands. So these are the examples of the roots, how roots, in spite of the complexities of trade, national politics, cultural complexities, it keeps on haunting. At the same time, I wanted to ask Professor Jain, Indian diaspora has not been able to provide a universal international cuisine as the cuisine of the Chinese noodles or Italian pizza. There is no alternative. We have not been able to give. Why? Perhaps Professor Jain would have given some potential answer. But a historian gave me a tentative answer. And I'll throw to you. Perhaps the basically indentured migrants of Indian origin, they were more concerned with food for survival. The daily survival was important. So the cuisine, the type of food for the table was hardly imagined and developed. Possibly here lies some answer, but I refuse to accept it. We'll look for the expert to give the answers. Again, I give some illustration to you. I export, or rather carry in my luggage as a present when I go to Mauritius. As a personal and family present, do you know what? Food of poor people. Sattu, red stuffed chili, pickle, and ritual items. Just see the type of thing you have. And these still are looked for. Still they remember. Still they need. Still they ask for. Entreat you to get it. Secondly, how I look at the text. Look at the statements had been made by Professor Jain in the text. Diasporic studies, by definition, refers to transnational transactions. The moment you are talking about diaspora, you are talking about more than two countries. By tradition, anthropologists have not been doing it. It refers to the linkages, the nature of linkages. So this is a very serious issue and at the same time very common issue. The second statement I found, multidisciplinarity is merely an outgrowth, but it is a fundamental aspect of anthropological enterprise.
It's not.
So this is one part of it, that anthropology by nature, I mean the chairman of the session did refer to it, that it is a discipline which is not necessarily studies only culture, it imbibes many other things. Thirdly, there has been a decisive fallout of the globalization, had been transformation of anthropological theme of looking for exotic to looking for divergence and different communities. By tradition anthropologists, we are always looking for exotic tribe or my village or my tribe. Now the situation has been very different, that you are looking for the diverse and different type of situations. Lastly, I repeat again, it is no doubt, it is a dense book by an intense scholar. Indian diaspora is spread in six major international blocks. Southeast Asia, West Asia, Africa, South Pacific, Europe, Gulf countries, and everywhere the problems are different. The type of problem we are facing, which this book doesn't refer to, West Asian money order economy. The present regime doesn't talk about it. You are talking about the cultural roots of the diaspora, but we are not talking about economic roots of the diaspora at the moment. And this is equally, we are more directly concerned with it, but it is missing from the national framework, national debate, and the text also, this book also. I'm not talking about, because I'm not competent to talk about South African case studies which the author has made, and Malaysian study, because I'm not competent to comment on that. Another contrasting thing Professor Jain notes through this book is, if you visit abroad and visit the diaspora, you will find out the presence of Indian in any country is dispersed. Compared to the Chinese, you will always find a Chinatown. But why it happens? Professor Jain provides a very logical answer to it, that while the Chinese travel abroad was largely voluntary, the Indian diaspora was forced as indentured labor, and they had to live in, not their choice, but they were dispersed in the rural areas to work in the plantations. So this provides part of the answer. Lastly, I don't have much to say. What does bind the diaspora to the mother India? I tell you, there was a professor from West Indies, Professor Somaru. He was educated from Delhi University. He was a historian. And he came looking to India for many things. By the way, he was a Catholic, but he was very proud Indian. He will talk about Indian tradition, Indian culture, in spite of being a Roman Catholic. And there he had a big, huge problem based on the race. So I asked him, after he gave a talk, what puzzles you after visiting India? And he used to visit very extensively, incognito, without announcing that he's from West Indies. He was just like any other Indian. He gave the example. He said, we are very much puzzled to see why Hindu and Muslims, they quarrel. Because they're both the same. I said, but what happens to your country? He said, he talked to me in this one on Bhojpuri. He said, we call it कले बियाह कले मियावे से कले वो आपन है कलुआ से निखे करेगे नॉट टू अ ब्लैक अफ्रीकन बिकॉज देयर द रेस इज वेरी रिलेवेंट देयर बट ही इज आवर मैन ही मे बी मुस्लिम मैरी टू हिम ही इज आवर मैन ही सेड वी गेट पजल्ड व्हेन वी कम दैट व्हाई हिंदू मुस्लिम आर क्वारलिंग व्हाट इज द क्वारल फॉर बोथ ऑफ यू आर पुअर बोथ ऑफ यू आर रिच वी डू नॉट अंडरस्टैंड दिस. So what I'm trying to say, what does the diaspora look to India for? And this we do not try to answer. Till other day they were very proud when India became independent, diaspora was looking to you. In the beginning, the first prime minister of the country, he did invite some of the diaspora people to join India. And at least two I know, one of my relatives from Mauritius, Ram Govardhan, came and he joined Indian Foreign Service. And India used to send him to all French-speaking countries because, you see, Mauritius, their national language was French at that time. And another gentleman came, I.J. Bahadur Singh from West Indies. He became another diplomat. So what I'm trying to tell you that the moment you are growing, those countries have become independent. What type of exchange we are having? What type of, you know, looking to each other is having, and how fruitful it is being translated. Perhaps we should also look for some answer. Let us not leave all these to the government. It is also the duty of the scholars, public intellectuals, to debate and think, if possible, suggest, or otherwise try to look for it. I stand here to congratulate, I will not say my friend, he was much senior to me, Professor Chan. I look to him, we meet frequently, and congratulations to Professor Jain for beautiful, I repeat, very dense book. And my publisher, Rutledge is also my publisher. 2 years back, another book was released here, written by me. So thank you very much for giving this opportunity. Thank you.